Hello and welcome to the Queens Public Library. Today's program is Where the Birds, Birdwatching in NYC. My name is Parissa Jarzinka and I am a customer service representative at Hunters Point at Queens Public Library. Before we begin today's program, just a few notices. QPL is open for to-go service, so you can pick up and return materials at a number of locations. To learn more about our to-go services, the virtual QPL programs, access digital service, or get an e-card, visit queenslibrary.org. You can take QPL with you wherever you are. Our digital materials are available 24/7 from anywhere with an internet connection. Now, through the year, the library is celebrating kindness with our annual It's Time for Kind campaign. Join us for virtual kindness program. Participate in our social media canned food challenge using hashtag QueensCan and write on our kindness e-wall. Learn how to get involved at queenslibrary.org. Consider giving to the Queens Library Public Foundation to uplift your community. All gifts May through December 31st will be matched by a group of generous donors. Help us offer online courses, expand our collection of ebooks, and more. Visit qplf.org/match20 to contribute. Now, in regards to today's program, whether you're gearing up for the Christmas bird count or preparing for spring, we will be learning more about the tools, techniques, and awesome joy of bird watching in New York City. We do want to mention that this is one of many and that this program series for the Hunters Point Environmental Education Center will be happening periodically on Saturdays at 2 p.m. on YouTube Live. We will be taking a short break for the holidays, but we will return on January 9th for Under the Microscope DYI. Check the comments as we'll be putting it in the link for that event so you can set a reminder. These programs are made possible by the Newtown Creek Environmental Benefit Fund, administered by City Parks Foundations and founded by the New York State Department of Environmental Conservation. And if you're inspired by our talks, join our iNaturalist community and help us photograph Hunters Point environment. Link will be in the live chat. As such, it is my pleasure to introduce Annie Novak, who is the founder and director of Growing Chefs, a field-to-fork food education program, the manager of the Edible Academy at the New York Botanical Garden, and co-founder and farmer of nation's first commercial green roof farm, the Eagle Street Rooftop Farm in Brooklyn, New York. She is the author and illustrator of the Rooftop Growing Guide, How to Transform Your Roof into a Garden or Farm, and was recognized by the UPON Society's Women in Conservation Program. Annie writes for Living Bird and Bird Conservation, among other publications, and has served on the board of the American Bird Conservancy since 2018. If you have any questions for Annie, please write them in the live chat as we will have a Q&A at the end of the session. Please welcome Annie Novak.
Hi, thank you so much for that kind introduction. Thanks to all of you for joining us, and thanks to the Queens Public Library for your support of this program and your support of me and the chance to talk about birds. I'm very grateful for that. And today is actually a very exciting day to talk about birds. As Parissa mentioned, it is time to do the Christmas bird count, which is a winter season opportunity for citizen science. And if you've never been a citizen scientist before, come on in. It's very easy to get involved. And the Christmas bird count is a really neat way over 100 years now to census what the population of wintering birds are in your area. So just this morning, actually, I went out to Breezy Point Tip, which is on the coastline of New York and New York City, and saw about 30 different species of bird in about a mile's distance. It was really remarkable. No, I did not see a snowy owl, but I'm very optimistic that there will be one on the beach this winter. So keep your eyes peeled. Today I'm going to talk about a number of things. As was explained in the introduction, I really want this talk to be about getting you more confident and excited about joining the birding community. Whether that's just you and your housemate, or you and your family, or you and your neighbors, or traveling to see birds all around the world. One of the most incredible things about living in New York, living in North Brooklyn, Queens, living near Hunters Point, is that we are in this incredibly ecologically unique space to see many, many, many different kinds of birds. Something that hit me really hard the first time I started birding in New York City was that I had always thought about birds as a uniform group of animals. One bird was just like another bird. But as you probably know, but it takes a minute to sink in. They're all different species, right? So you can see a really wide range of adaptations in flight, in plumage, and behavior, in breeding period, in food preferences, in the way they raise their young. I mean, the way they see the world with different types of eyes, it's really remarkable. So even just focusing on this one group of animals, you can learn an awful lot about birds. But I have found in the many years that I've been birding, I've also learned an awful lot about New York City. And so that's what I want to walk you through in my presentation. So with no further ado, let's jump over to the slides and I'm going to show you guys some images here. Starting with this really beautiful old map of Hunter's Point. This is a map from the Library of Congress. And as you can see from the graphics on it, it represents an area that's similar and yet quite different than what we have today. Those strike marks and the bushy little lines indicate a marshy wetlands area. And you'll see that Hunter's Point actually had a river running north up through it off of the Newtown Creek there for a very long time. And so one thing to consider as I show you habitats where birds now live in Hunter's Point is that this is a very recent historical legacy of the area. And part of what makes birds so interesting is that they are, of course, generationally adapting to the changes within New York City. But a lot of them have been making this migration over North America since the last glaciation, since glaciers covered New York City. So these are old habits. And as we all know, old habits die hard. So it's very exciting to go to Hunter's Point and see birds and to think about the fact that they've been making, a lot of the species that we see have been making the same migration pattern for thousands and thousands of years. So first things first about birds. I did not start my life excited about birds, but if you're joining us today, maybe you're already into them, maybe you're just starting to catch whiff of the trend. But the key thing to keep in mind about these incredible animals is that they are living descendants of dinosaurs. You just want to hold that thought in your mind for a second, because we all learn over and over and over again that the dinosaurs, quote unquote, went extinct. But as we are learning, and even within my lifetime, we've uncovered so much information about this area. But birds are, in fact, living dinosaurs. They are a direct thread connecting us back to an animal that lived millions and millions of years ago. And I find that absolutely fascinating. New York City, of course, has many examples of living fossils. For example, the horseshoe crabs that come up every June are an example of a living fossil, but the birds have evolved from dinosaurs that are the direct descendants, that we've been able to see the formation of feathers over time through the fossil record is really incredible. And I mentioned feathers, that is in fact what makes a bird a bird. So if there are around 10,000 species of birds in the world, the thing that unifies them is this remarkable adaptation, the feather, which helps keep them warm, it helps with breeding, it helps with, of course, flight, which may very well be the darndest best thing about birds. Birding in New York is even more special of an opportunity than a lot of other places in the country. North America has about close to 1,000 species of birds. So one of the things that differentiates North America from Central and South America is that diversity. You could probably imagine why Central and South America might have a couple thousand more species of birds. It's because in North America, of course, we're a little bit more limited by our winter periods and by our lack of tropical regions. So the closer you get to the equator, you're going to see a lot more diversity in bird species. But nonetheless, 1,000 birds out of the 10,000 in the world is no small number. And of that, unbelievably, New York State sees 476 species of birds. So close to half that are present in New York State alone. And if you consider the diversity of ecosystems across North America, from the Everglades to the Rocky Mountains to the Southwest and its dry deserts, it's really remarkable that half of these birds are found in New York State. And this last number blows my mind. Close to 40% of all North American birds pass through just New York City, which can feel like a big place because it feels very important to live there. We have millions of people living there, but it's actually geographically not that large. And so the fact that we get 40% of all North American birds coming through makes us, I think, terrifically special. And it only puts more pressure on any conservation action we can do to make sure that our New York City stays hospitable to these beautiful birds coming through. So why do so many birds come through New York? Well, keep in mind, when I'm talking about 40% of North American birds coming through, a lot of them are moving through on migration. which is to say many different types of times of the year. For example, right now, a lot of owls are migrating. So don't just think that migration is limited only to the spring and to the fall. A lot of shorebirds migrate in the summer. As I mentioned, we're seeing a lot of owls come through now. I also this morning saw snow buntings, horned larks. These are birds that come through only in the wintertime or come south only in the wintertime. But there are two key geographical reasons why New York City sees an awful lot of birds. One, of course, is that we're on the coast, and a lot of birds use that coastline as a way of migrating down south and then following it back up north again. And then, of course, we have this beautiful, beautiful preserved forest right above us. And that forest is a continuum of boreal forest, which is a really important breeding space for birds. The other thing that's interesting about New York, and I'll talk a little bit more about this later, is that we have urban light pollution. A lot of the birds that I'm going to talk about, or some of the birds I'm going to show you today, migrate at night. And one thing to consider about that migration habit is that at night, you get a lot of sky glow. You get a lot of light pollution. A couple of nights ago, when it snowed very heavily, you might have noticed, if you live in New York City, that it was very, very bright all night long. I mean, 11:30 at night, 4:30 in the morning, it was very, very bright. And that had to do with that low cloud ceiling during the nor'easter and all of the light pollution bouncing up and hitting that cloud ceiling and then coming right back to us. So light pollution is an aggregator for a lot of nocturnal migrants. Depends on the species, and it's a little more complicated than I can explain in this talk, but the essence of it is that light pollution draws birds towards New York City at a regional scale. And there's been a lot of really great scientific research done on this because, of course, once birds end up in a city, cities aren't the greatest habitat for birds. There's danger with window strikes. There's a lot less food than you could get elsewhere in terms of insect and plant resources. Nonetheless, it does make New York City an exciting place to be a birder because a lot of these birds drawn into the city then have to make their way around for a couple of days before they continue on their journey. So here are just a few, a very, very few of those several hundred species of birds that come through New York City. These are my favorites, though it's hard to pick favorites. I feel like it rotates seasonally. But the Baltimore Oriole, for example, was my spark bird, which is the first bird that made me fall in love with birding. One of the things that makes the Baltimore Oriole so special is that it builds beautiful nests. They're shaped like pendulum or like teardrops, and they hang off of trees. And they'll stay even long after the Baltimore Oriole has left. And so for me, it was actually well after the Baltimore Orioles had migrated and the leaves had fallen off the trees in the fall that I first noticed that pendulum nest hanging. I was so intrigued by the shape because I was a kid who grew up drawing the classic cup-shaped robin's nest that I went ahead and looked up what bird it was and was amazed to discover that it was a Baltimore Oriole, a bird that makes its way all the way down to Central and South America and lives there for most of the year. This was made even more special when I had my first opportunity as an adult to go down to the Amazon. And while traveling down the Amazon River, I saw a bird's nest that belonged to an oropendula. An oropendula is a much larger, I think that bird is about close to a foot tall, much larger relative of the Baltimore Oriole. And like the Baltimore Oriole, it also builds pendulum-shaped nests. And then once I was astonished by meeting its relative, I happened to come around the corner in a boat, and there, lo and behold, was a Baltimore Oriole right there on the banks of the Amazon River, the same bird that I had seen in the Bronx that summer. It was absolutely remarkable to get a true sense of how far these birds travel. Northern Sawit owls are birds that are actually in New York City right now. I will flag this and say, if you see an owl, please leave it alone. They sleep during the day, they need the break, they don't wanna be harassed. But that all said, it is really terrifically exciting to see them because they are such special and interesting raptors. Sawit owls are the smallest owl in North America. They're super teeny tiny. They often hang out, for example, in Floyd Bennett Field, which is a really neat ecological space to check out. Bobolinks are probably at the top of my list. This is a really seasonal bird. It only shows up in the summer. And one of the things that's most special about them is their call, which you'll often hear as they're flying overhead. And I want to play that for you. Unreal. What an incredible bird. And compare that, for example, to another one of my favorite birds, the oven bird, which is a thrush. And Also a beautiful song. This is actually one of the things that for most people make birds really special is the singing that they do. And I encourage you, if you're interested in getting started in birding, to check out Birding by Ear as a resource. It's hard, but the better you get at birding by ear, the better you are at identifying birds when there's a lot of foliage on trees. So even though it's, I think as a visual species, humans really like to learn what birds look like, but I've found more and more that the better I am at identifying birds' flight calls, alarm calls, and songs, the better I am at finding birds. Birds aren't the only thing up in the sky. I'm just gonna go a quick nod to some other migrants that might be floating in the air above you, and this includes honeybees, aphids, spiders, pollen. There are all sorts of things up in the air above New York City. It's, again, part of what makes New York City so special. And this space above us, this ecosystem in the air, is recently, I think since about 2017 was the first conference on aeroecology, is very recently being recognized as a really precious ecosystem. So again, as terrestrial species who are very visually oriented, humans often focus on things that are out and about around us. But it was only in the 1950s that we started looking in the ocean with any really good tools and real seriousness. And it's only now, as I said, as recently as 2017, that we've started considering air and the airspace above us in the same way. And I find this tremendously exciting. My whole fascination with birds, once I had seen the Baltimore Oriole, recognized how far it migrates, then turned quickly to seeing how deep and rich and sophisticated everything up above us was. So I'm not gonna talk too much more about that now, but if aeroecology intrigues you, I beg you to reach out to me because there's a lot more to talk about that. So let's drill down on Hunter's Point. I have just put up a Google Map satellite image of what Hunter's Point looks like now. Again, if you remember the map I showed at the very beginning, it's pretty different, but the coastline generally remains the same. And you know, birds use a lot of these water features around New York City to help them migrate towards the city. So the fact that the Hudson River and the East River, you know, are still definite south-pointing arrows for birds coming down from Canada and the Arctic North to travel down to their South American and Central American overwintering grounds, those are still, the rivers are still great navigational tools for these birds. I've circled a couple of different interesting areas that are worth checking out. I will acknowledge that Roosevelt Island is not part of Hunter's Point, but it's a newly developed park, and the rocks around its shoreline have been really interesting places in the winter to spot things, you know, that use the water as an area to feed. The smaller circle right below is Youth Ant Island, which is a very peculiar tumble of rocks that I think used to host a radio transmitter tower right in front of the United Nations. And this is quite famously a nesting site for double-crested cormorants. If you've ever been standing on the waterline, the shoreline in Hunter's Point and looked and seen a very quickly moving, long, lean black bird with sort of a thumbprint-shaped belly right over the water flapping fast, that's probably a double-crested cormorant. You might also see them floating on the water and dropping under, disappearing for a couple of seconds and popping back up again while you're waiting for the ferry, the East River ferry. So this is a great spot to look out for those birds, particularly when they're breeding. The lower, larger circle is the newly developed park at Hunter's Point. It's part of the Gantry State Park, I believe. And the lower area in particular, the whole park is really lovely. And of course, the Hunter's Point Library and Environmental Center is right there. But the lower part of the park is particularly special because of the plant choices that they made. And I cannot underscore this enough. If you want to be a good birder, you need to go where there are good plants. Birds like rock pigeons that can adapt to living in skyscrapers, red-tailed hawks, similarly, they love to live on the top of our buildings, just like they would in the wild on big rocky cliffs. But if you need to find birds that are looking for food, plants really help. And this isn't just because birds eat the plants. They don't just eat the seed heads and the berries, et cetera. They're there because insects are there. So the more native plants you have, the more native insects, the more those insectivore birds or birds that are seasonally insectivorous can enjoy a good food source. So this landscape in particular, I was very excited to see their native plantings of things like lots of different kinds of oak trees, sweet gums, et cetera. And then the last little circle there on the right is right over the Kosciuszko Bridge and a warehouse next to it. The bridge is a great place to post up and to look in the summer for migrants like great cormorants. sorry, totally blanking on the name for a second. gray blue herons and yellow crowned night herons, which is rare but possible. And then in the winter and the fall, it's a great time to look for gulls. And gulls are something that the longer you bird, the more exciting they get. This morning, again, when I was out on the Christmas bird count, we were looking at huge masses of gulls on the beach, which I think typically people would sort of brush off because they come to eat your French fries and they're just constantly making noise. But the reality is that gulls also have really interesting plumage, behaviors, and migration patterns. For example, this morning, one of the most exciting gulls we saw were Bonaparte's gulls, which are teeny tiny compared to great blackback or herring gulls. And they only pop up in the winter. So that bridge is a really great spot to keep an eye out on the rooftops, the warehouse rooftops around for gulls, and then also for rafts of them floating on the river or on the creek, sorry. I've also seen mergansers there, which is pretty neat, common mergansers. So how do you find these birds? Well, over the last decade plus, eBird has become a really excellent resource for people out birding, looking to keep track of their birding habits, and also for birders who are trying to find a good spot to bird. So I'm using Hunter's Point as an example, just to show you how this tool works. And actually, let me see if I, I was gonna say, I can see if I can drop that link in this in the chat for you all, but it doesn't matter. I'm actually showing it on the screen, so that's fine. What you'll wanna do is go to eBird.org, and there's an option there to Perfect. Thank you. There's an option to put that website in, and then from there to look up, for example, hotspots. And when you do a hotspots check, you'll see all of these tiny little bubbles pop up, for example, in green and in, in blue and in yellow and in pale blue. And each of those, when you click on them, is a live hotspot list. So as you can see circled here, it'll tell you how many species have been spotted in total all year round. So this is a little bit tricky because some of these records might be records that folks have entered after eBird was invented. So you might see a record from like 1908, an incredibly rare bird. If it's that old, you may not see it again. But for anything that's contemporary, and particularly if you limit your search to this year or the year previous within a certain season, you'll be able to drill down on what birds you might want to, you might see while you're out there. So I have circled a gantry park, Gantry Plaza State Park, because you'll see that those show up in a pale blue, which indicates that you're going to see a good number of species there. And then First Calgary Cemetery, I just wanted to flag as a space that's a little underbirded near Hunter's Point, but it's definitely worth checking out because cemeteries typically have great trees. And those great trees, of course, attract great insects, ergo, excellent birds. Your next cool tool on eBird, if you look up a particular hotspot, is you're able to look at all of the photos that have been recorded in that hotspot. So of course, this relies on people going to the hotspot, selecting that as their location, going birding, making their birding list, and then uploading photos. If they have uploaded photos, you get a cool grid like this of all the different birds that have been seen in that area. And the reason I like to do this is, well, there are a couple of reasons. Number one is it shows all the birds in their typical behavior. So for example, you see a gull in the water and you see the thrush or robin in a tree. You're not really going to see a gull in a tree and a robin in the water, right? So if you're unfamiliar with birds, this is a great place to start looking at how they behave, where they are, where you might expect them. So if you just want to take a second and look at all the different habitats represented here, omitting of course the gull in flight, which all birds can do. We have birds on the ground. We have birds perched in trees. We have birds that are perched differently. We have birds that are comfortable on the ground, scuffling around in leaf litter. We have birds that seem to prefer swimming in the water, et cetera. And all of that is really helpful. So again, it's a silly example, but I do think about this a lot when I travel and I'm looking for birds for the first time in a new habitat. What are some of the birds that might hang out near water versus one of the birds that might hang out on leaf litter versus up in a tree? And that will help me narrow down when I'm looking through my binoculars, frantically trying to flip through a field guide at the same time. It narrows down which birds I'm looking for straight away. So again, these are all user generated. If you yourself are out birding and you take some good photos, you can upload them to eBird to match that hotspot list, and you can see how much it helps people. The other thing this helps with is breeding plumage. So birds, not all, but most, go through a transition in their feathers during breeding season and then in their off season. Some also have different plumage when they're juveniles versus adults, and some of them exhibit different plumage when they're female versus male. So all of this is of course shown in these photos. often, not always, but often it will list what plumage is represented in the photo. And if not, it will definitely give you the date. And the date, of course, can help. If you look up the breeding period of that bird and you're looking at a photo from that breeding period, there you go. You're looking at breeding plumage, for example. So just as a little quiz for you, you're not going to be graded. I'm not going to ask you to report it to me. Just for starters, see if you can find the bird in this photo. Now, this is a photo taken just with my camera phone and no binoculars at all. So hopefully you've located the dark brown blackish spot up in a tree. So the first thing I would note about this photo is this was taken about a week ago. So if I was looking at the eBird checklist and trying to figure out, what was this bird I saw in Hunter's Point? The first thing I would note is that it is a winter bird. So I can immediately say, it's probably not about 20 different species of warbler. It might be the other four. And then by size, I might say, oh, it looks like it's about the size of a robin, but it doesn't have the same coloring as a robin, which in the winter, in fact, usually appear a little bit lighter. So I've already seen that it's a darkish bird, about robin-sized, and it's going to be a bird that stays in New York year-round, or at the very least is a rarity that's just hanging on too long. It is alone. So the first thing I do, there are birds that like to hang out alone. There are birds that like to hang out in flocks. There are birds that like to hang out as pairs. I might say, okay, well, this is alone. So let me just do a quick scan and make sure that it really is all by itself. And I looked over at the pylons just to the left of that group of trees on the water. And lo and behold, there were a bunch of other small brownish blackish little birds. So I waited for a second to look at their behavior. Did they all fly off together? Did they stay posted up? Did any of them go near the water? And ultimately what happened is they all gathered up as a group and took off, making a bunch of cheerful calls. And so I was able, through all these different clues, to narrow it down to a couple different birds and ultimately ended up being a starling. Starlings are probably birds that are familiar to all of you. It's the bird shown on the top left hanging out in the grass. And what's cool about starlings is that they're an introduced species. They're not a native species. And you might push back immediately and say, well, that's not cool. That's terrible. As a plant person, I hear you. Invasive species are no fun. But the thing that's neat about starlings is that this is a bird that was introduced in the 1800s by a man who was a fan of William Shakespeare's plays. And he brought them from Europe over to the U.S. And released them in Central Park. So they have a little bit of a history here in New York. And the reason I say they're kind of cool is because what the starlings have done as an invasive species with such a small original population, now they live all across North America. We've had a chance over the last century plus to study starlings as they've changed and adapted genetically while living in the US. And this is a really rare opportunity for scientists studying bird evolution to just watch it happen live. We have very accurate records of when they first got here, what they were like when they got here, et cetera, because this is one of the birds that's very frequently collected by natural history museums. They're also fantastic singers, and they have this beautiful star-spangled plumage. So don't knock starlings. You're going to see a lot of them when you're out birding for the first time, and they have really interesting sociable behavior. Birding and in the park, I'm focusing on Gantry State Park in particular. One of the things that's really fabulous about it is in addition to all these birds that you might see hanging out near the plants and land, is there are a lot of opportunities to see bird out on the river. What I've circled here are some groups of gulls. And again, as this was a week ago, I was trying to figure out, am I lucky enough to see great black-back gulls? Might there be a lesser black-back gull? Ultimately, these are herring gulls and ring-billed gulls, which are super neat finds. You'll see them most of the year in New York, but nonetheless, really terrific to check out. So this leads me to suggesting binoculars as one of the tools you invest in. And I'll show you at the end of my talk. I actually have two pairs. One are my Zeiss Terra ED. Those are 8x42s. And that's a heavier, more technical pair of binoculars that I like to use when I'm birding seriously. I also have my running binoculars. When I go out for a run and I have my little backpack, I'll take along my Wingspan binocs, which are 8x32, so they're a little bit smaller. I wish I had had either of those with me that day when I was running a week ago, because I would have been able to get you better pictures of these gulls. So very quickly, I'm going to shoot through a couple of resources, and I've squared them off in yellow here. This is the section of my phone that's dedicated to being a nerd, and what I've got squared off are some of my favorite birding apps. I'm going to talk about RadarScope in a minute, but flag that as a non-birding app that will nonetheless help you bird. The rest that are listed up here, if you want to take a screenshot, are fantastic ways to focus in on bird identification through song, through sight, through hotspots. Hotspots is a tool that I believe eBird developed that's specifically what I was showing you how to do on eBird, like find a hotspot location. And then my top two, which is why they're sitting here all by themselves, are Sibley Birds and eBird. So eBird we've talked about a little bit. I want to show you how to use the Sibley app. So here we have three screenshots from left to right. The left is the initial menu. What you want to make sure is that you select your location. So I've selected New York. The next thing you'll get when you go into taxonomic index right there at the top is a whole list of birds. And the Sibley's bird app is organized much like the Sibley's guide, which weighs like 45 pounds, which is why the app is so useful. You can scroll through each of these. And when you click on a certain bird, you'll see that far right screen pop up, which is a visual list of the way the bird can appear in the breeding and non-breeding season, as well as different parts of the country. So I've selected brants. Brants are goose looking like birds, or Canada goose looking like birds. And they're around in the winter. They're an absolutely fantastically beautiful bird. They're typically a little smaller than a Canada goose. And they have this beautiful pearly necklace of feathers right around their throats. Now, if I wanted to double check if something was a brant and not a Canada goose, the next thing I might look at is the range map. So down at the bottom left of my screen, you can see there's a little mountains icon, and then there's a little text icon, and then there's a globe icon. And the globe icon shows you where in the world brants might be. So one of the first things I do when I've seen a bird, I'm like, oh yeah, definitely brant, 100%, is I click on that globe icon and I make sure that it's a bird that typically appears in New York City this time of year. So as you can see, brants do show up in New York in the wintertime, hence the blue on our coast. That's not to say that a bird might not have just shown up. It's rare birds appear all the time, but this is a good confirmation to start with. The next thing I'll look up is that little tab that's it sort of looks like a folded newspaper. That's the text that tells you its typical location, its typical size, and its behavior and voice. So reading this through helps you confirm the bird. Just stand there and observe it for a couple of minutes, make sure it's in the right place at the right time, et cetera. Again, it might be a rare thing. You might've been the guy who spotted the amazing bird, but just in case, this helps confirm it. Then the next feature, which I really like, is called compare. So back in the species menu, you get an option to click a little button that lets you pull up two species at once. So that far right image shows a Canada goose at the top, very familiar friend. And at the bottom, it shows brant. And this is a little hard to show you without showing you live in the app. But if you get the app, you'll see you can scroll through the pictures next to each other. And this will help you look at them both at once. And this is really helpful because, again, if you're not sure if it's a Canada goose or a brant, you can look at them side by side as illustrated. And that will help you figure it out even further. OK, now my favorite tool of all. As I mentioned, I got really into aeroecology a number of years ago. And when you start to study aeroecology as a novice, one of the best tools for looking at birds is to understand their night migration behavior. So the best thing, I think, to happen in my lifetime that it helps explain nocturnal migration patterns is the use of radar. I say in my lifetime, but this is actually something that started to develop as long ago as the 1960s, fairly seriously. And what's happening now, because we have so many different radar stations all over the US, is we're able to do it much more broadly. And then, of course, because of technological developments, both in the radar and in AI and in computer processing, this has become an even better tool. So I'll show you the very rudimentary way to figure out if birds are on the move. So first things first, this website up at the top, radar.weather.gov, is a good place to start just to nerd out on radar. You can look this up right now. If, however, you happen to be awake at like 10 o'clock on a May evening, you might want to pull it up again because you'll start to see what I've indicated in the blue arrows, these beautiful blue and green blooms. And what that represents are birds rising up off the ground to migrate through the night sky. And so they're showing up on radar because radar picks up anything that has water in it. It'll pick up insects, it'll pick up birds, et cetera. So the yellow arrow indicates a storm system that probably looks familiar to you. But the blue and the green is primarily birds. Sometimes it's bats and sometimes it's insects, like I said, but this particular movement is principally birds. And the other thing you'll want to look up on the left, you see in the yellow square, is a screenshot of a weather app I have called Dark Sky. Dark Sky is a great weather app. And what I've shifted to in the app, you can see down there at the bottom, is the wind. So wind direction is a really helpful thing to understand too. Birds are very, very oriented or very, very aware of wind patterns. And so in the spring and the fall, when they're starting to migrate, you want to look for wind patterns that help them move. So for example, winds in the fall that are pushing from the north to the south, the next morning, you're probably going to wake up and see a lot of birds. So that's how you would use these two tools in combination. You would look at them at night. That would help you figure out who's flying up above when you are sleeping. And then the next morning, you could go out and see what birds have shown up. The last thing I want to mention about this nocturnal migration thing goes back to my point about light pollution. Light pollution draws birds into cities. And once they're in cities, after a long, typically very challenging movement of flight overnight, they end up in areas with a lot of reflective surfaces. And birds, like every other animal on Earth, don't know how to see glass. They have to learn to see glass. Humans are included in this. A baby is born not understanding glass, but they learn over time. Some bird species can. You know, you can see pigeons and red-tailed hawks navigating around New York with a lot less trouble than a lot of these neotropical migrants. But birds that are flying through New York City on their way to South and Central America in particular, young birds, first of the year birds, some of them have a really hard time. And the key thing to keep in mind is, as I mentioned at the top of this talk, all bird species are different. They see the world differently. So I can show you a picture. Oops, go back to that one. Of a very rough representation of this. But on the right, you'll see an image of a human's world view divided as green being the view that's in front of us and blue being peripheral vision. For birds, you can see that this is an example of a white stork, which is actually a European bird. But you can see that a lot of their primary vision is dominated by the peripheral. So what is directly in front of birds, not all species, but most, what's directly in front of them is a lot less important than what's around them and above them and to the side. So if you can imagine being a bird that's flying into a city with lots of reflective surfaces, the reflective surface in the early morning when the birds have just landed from their nocturnal flight and they're just starting to reorient themselves, like where are the good plants, where are the insects, they hop up and they start to fly in what's called morning flight, these little readjustment flights after their long night of travel. And as they do, that is a moment, because the sun is just coming up and the sky is reflecting in the windows, where it's particularly dangerous for birds. That's not to say that glass isn't dangerous for birds all times, but you know, overnight and in the early morning hours, it's particularly bad. And so what you'll start to see are birds, here circled on the bottom left, birds like the hermit thrush, which, you know, again, this is a bird that doesn't live in New York year round. It's on its way to better places. It prefers the low, scruffy understory of forest covered in oak leaves. This is a bird that doesn't recognize that window in the pre-dawn hours as glass. It just sees reflection and it strikes the window and concusses. And of course, not all the birds die, fortunately, but the concussion can be fairly serious. And more often than not, the reason we don't see these out and about is because they're scavenged by cats, which are actually the leading threat to all birds. Billions and billions of birds die every year because of feral cat populations and domestic cats who are out and about. But these birds will often get picked up. They'll be scavenged. So if you want to see dead bird carcasses, you do have to get out awfully early in the morning. But it happens a lot. So if you want to get involved, and if you want to do anything about this bird collision issue, I've listed a whole bunch of resources here. Again, a screenshot would be the easiest way to grab these. And the other resource is the American Bird Conservancy. As was mentioned, I'm on the board. I'm very, very excited about working with the American Bird Conservancy because they are one of the top leaders in working to prevent bird collisions as well as to prevent the danger that cats present to birds and to work on legislation. For example, right now, the Migratory Bird Treaty Act is under threat from the federal government, and ABC is doing an awful lot of good work trying to push back against that. And to sue the government into making sure that the American Bird Treaty Act continues to protect our migratory birds. So I encourage you to look them up as well. And I'm gonna drop a link for you before we close out our talk. But I wanna leave it here and just make sure there's a couple of minutes for questions if anybody has them. So thank you guys so much for joining us. I hope you're inspired to get out and go birding. It's a blast is all I can say. And you will not regret it if you go.
Annie, thank you so much for this beautiful presentation. It was awesome.
Thank you.
Before we begin our Q&A, I do want to reiterate, if you have any questions, please write them in the live chat. And a big thank you to Annie for her amazing presentation. And another big thank you to the New York Creek Environmental Benefit Fund, administered by City Parks Foundation and funded by the New York State Department of Environmental Conservation. So my first question is from Shabir G. He said, is the pigeon population increasing in New York City, and what is being done?
That's a great question. I don't have the data to answer that. Oops.
Okay. I think. I think we lost Annie. She'll be right back. I hope you guys enjoyed the presentation by Annie. She'll be right back. I think we lost her. Hi.
Apologize.
Just think it's okay.
No, I unplugged my monitor and the whole thing crashed. Okay. So pigeons in New York City, I don't know if the population is increasing or decreasing. What I will say about pigeons is that I really love them. I think they're a really interesting bird. They exhibit so many different social behaviors. If you're just learning how to bird, pigeons are one of the easiest ones to watch just to get a sense of how birds interact with each other. Obviously, every species is different, but if you do want to see birds being social, working as teams, cohabitating, it's a cool bird to watch. And they also have really beautiful different plumage. You can learn an awful lot about feather patterns and hybridization through watching pigeons.
Okay. Linda says, is there a way to learn to navigate eBird?
Yeah, I mean, it's a depending on what you're looking for, it's increasingly becoming a very intuitive site. What I would suggest, just to learn some easy tools, is to go to the website before you go to the app. And then once you're on the website, to look up your own neighborhood. Just zoom in on the map and click through the hotspots and just see what's out and about around you. And if you're starting with an area you're geographically familiar with, it'll be a lot easier to go through the species list, et cetera. One of my favorite features, which I didn't show in the talk, but is worth checking out, is you can actually look up bird species. It comes right off the top drop bar. And when you look up species, you'll start to see all the spaces in the world where that species lives. So if there's a bird near you that you're already familiar with, like, I don't know, the northern cardinal. If you want to look up the cardinal first and see all the different places across America where it's made its home, that's a great way just to start using the tool in a bird-focused way as opposed to like a human-focused way. Just kind of neat.
Okay. Princess Yamela said, are there any events for local kids to participate near the public parks that's free and safe, maybe where they can borrow binoculars or volunteer to teach them?
I'm really glad you asked that. We have an excellent local chapter of Audubon, the New York City Audubon. This year, it's a little tricky with the borrowing binoculars part, but they do a great job with free bird walks. And if you look up their website, New York City Audubon, they should have a list of what events they are offering right now. In the meantime, the binoculars that I mentioned as my running binoculars, again, these are called, it's a brand called Wingspan, and they're 8x32s. You can see they're small. These are really good for kids. I want to say that they're well under $100, which sounds like an investment, and I totally hear you. I took a long, long time to buy my binoculars, but at the end of the day, as you've seen from inheriting your grandfather's binoculars, these are tools that last a long time. So that could work. And then the last thing is, you don't necessarily have to have binoculars to bird. The photos I showed from my run that were sort of at a distance, I was closer than those photos indicate, and I was birding just naked eye. And Brooklyn Bridge Park is actually a great place to do that, as well as Hunter's Point, because you get so many different species so close to you because of the plant population.
Okay, Yvonne said, can anyone have a pigeon coop?
Ooh, that's a great question. I want to say that the only restriction on raising pigeons, which again, these are not rock doves, these are not the pigeons that live in New York, these are birds you would buy. The only restriction might be getting permission to be on your roof, which is where I would recommend putting it. And then potentially permitting to build it. I will say from personal experience, I built a chicken coop on a roof once and I was fined for that by the city of New York. So I would check that out first. But in terms of actually having the birds, yes, that is permissed. Only hooved animals, I believe, are illegal in New York.
Okay, Spurs asks, what species use birdhouses?
Ooh, that's a wonderful question as well. So the Cornell Lab of Ornithology website, which I think is just cornellbirds.edu. Cornell Lab of Ornithology is what you want to look up. They have an excellent backyard birding section where they talk about all the different birdhouses you should build. The first thing I would do before building a birdhouse, I wouldn't think of my dream bird and then build the birdhouse. For example, I wouldn't say purple martins and then grow squashes and hang those in my yard, because it's not really likely that I'm going to get purple martins here in Brooklyn. But if you do start to bird and you have a sense of what your yard birds are, and you do have a sense if they need birdhouses or not, for example, the song sparrows that hang out in my yard, they build nests on the ground. They don't need a birdhouse. But once you put all those different pieces together, I would build the house to suit the birds that live near you. And then in terms of how to build them, et cetera, birds are fairly particular, not just about the house and the shape and the size of the hole and the depth and how it opens, but also the height that they're hung, what plants they're around. So it can get a little complicated, but don't let that dissuade you. If anything, I might start with a bird feeder and go nuts with that and just see what you get.
Okay, so I have a question. If someone is interested in this field, how would they get involved?
Sure. Well, depending on what you mean by field, I can tell you I mentioned a couple different disciplines while rattling along. Ornithology, the study of birds. Radar ornithology, the study of birds under radar. Bird watching, which anybody can do as a citizen scientist. Aeroecology, which is the study of everything that moves up in the air around us. And then just birding. So far, you're already involved. You're already thinking about birding. But for the rest of those, I just started picking up textbooks. I literally went out and bought the textbook called Aeroecology and just started reading about it. And then through meeting other birders, talking to them, learning about their backgrounds, a lot of the better birders in New York actually have PhDs in this stuff, and you can just ask them.
Okay. So what is the best location for bird watching in the city? Besides
every single place. Birding New York is so terrifically special, and there is no quote unquote best place in the sense that if I was to say to you, well, Central Park is an incredible hotspot, I would be totally missing out on, for example, Breezy Point Tip, which is where I went this morning, the Rockaways, Jamaica Bay. It really depends what you're looking for. One of the most exciting new places, if you haven't checked it out, is the Shirley Chisholm State Park, which is this enormous, hundreds of acres state park that just got opened up. And Shirley Chisholm is a great space to see grassland species of birds. And I want to say clapper rails. I hope I'm right. In any case, it really depends what you're looking for. But the reality is wherever you are is a great place to bird. If you're sitting and waiting for the bus, it's a great place to bird. There are birds everywhere in New York. It's part of what makes it so special.
Okay, Margaret X, do blue jays stay all winter?
Yeah, in fact, it's not all blue jays, but I believe not only do some blue jays stay, but some blue jays that you're seeing in the winter are blue jays that have just come from north to south. So you're getting to meet some new, potentially Canadian friends.
Okay, and Princess Simela asks, is the Nikon 765, it's light, do you recommend it to use for bird watching?
I don't know if I know that, but if it's, I don't even know if that's a camera or binoculars. That's a great question.
She's saying it's a butterfly binoculars, she's saying it's a butterfly binoculars.
Oh, it's called, because there are also Monarch, is that?
Oh yeah, she just said Nikon 765. I'm not sure.
No problem. What I will say about binoculars generally in New York, we do have, I don't want to sound like I'm a little globbing out promotional things here, but B&H, which is a camera and optic equipment store in New York City, is a great place to start. And they'll let you, or have in the past before pandemic times, let you go in and actually try out the binoculars. The other thing I did, which helped me pick out mine, which are, again, the Zeiss Terra ED, I asked other people if I could try their binoculars. So again, maybe post-pandemic times, but it's a great way, just testing other people's tools out in the field is a great way to figure it out. And you wanna think about like weight, you're gonna be holding them up like this a lot, so start lifting your weights. and then also just like size, like how big of an optic field do you want? I find that the 8x42 is a really good place to start, because it means that I'm, you know, right in the range that's comfortable for me. Some binoculars you see a wider field of view, some smaller. 8x42s is a pretty classic place to start.
Linda asks, she bought a birdhouse and she installed it in her trees, but no birds visited. She just wanted to know why.
I think it would depend on what type of birdhouse Linda bought, because as I mentioned, birds are fairly species specific about how they build their habitats. Most birdhouses are trying to approximate something that would be appropriate for like a cavity dwelling bird. And you have to, you know, again, like if you put the birdhouse up and you haven't checked if that bird is already a regular in your general area, or if it's at the right height, or if it's in the right cluster of plants or not plants, all of those things can affect what the bird will do with it.
Margaret asks, are woodpeckers indigenous to New York?
We have several native species of woodpecker. So depending on which ones you're talking about, some of my absolute favorite, let's see, we have hairy woodpecker, there's yellow-bellied sapsucker, downy woodpecker, the northern flicker, which is a really amazing bird. And in fact, if you've ever heard of the Peterson guides, Roger Troy Peterson was a birder who grew up as a teenager birding in the Bronx. He is an absolute icon in the world of birds. And his spark bird, I mentioned mine was the Baltimore Oriole. His spark bird was the northern flicker, which over on our side of the country, when it flies up, it flashes this beautiful yellow. Out west, it flashes a beautiful red. So it's a cool species to look at depending on where you are in the U.S.
Okay, Yvonne asks, how can you attract red cardinals?
It's a great question. So red cardinals, if I'm remembering correctly, are primarily insectivores. I'd have to look that up, but they also are seed eaters. I wonder if I know. But the point I'm trying to make is that if you were to go, for example, to the Cornell Lab of Ornithology website, or if you were to look in your Sibley Bird Guide, both of those books would give you an indication of what food they like to eat. And that would be a really great way to get them started coming near you. The other thing you'll notice if you're a person who watches the cardinal out and about is that they seem to really like getting up to, you know, like 12, 15 feet high and just really loudly broadcasting with that car alarm song that they are there. So if you are able to plant plants or put up a post or something that would help that cardinal get up there and tee up and start singing, that might be another great way to do it.
Arlene asked, are there woodpeckers in Queens Botanical Garden?
I wonder, there must be. So again, going back to this food source and habitat and plant cycle that pulls birds in, the Queens Botanic Garden has just an absolutely beautiful collection of all sorts of different plants and habitats. And certainly if there are really good oak trees there, which I know there are, you would definitely see woodpeckers. And that has a lot to do with the fact that our native oaks support hundreds of different kinds of insects, like 300, 400, 500. So it's a strong connection between the oak, the insect, and the woodpecker.
Aditi asks, do birds hibernate if they don't migrate?
It's a really good question. Hibernation is such an interesting behavioral pattern. And here's the cool thing about birds, right? So up at the top of the talk, when I said there are 10,000 species of birds and that close to 400 of them move or migrate or live in New York City, migration is a big way to not hibernate, right? Because most of hibernation is about, you know, hanging out, not eating food, trying to make it through the winter, et cetera. And birds that can migrate, of course, don't need to hibernate. So as far as I know, there are no hibernating birds in New York, although there are birds, of course, that overwinter and stay active and eat through the winter as well.
Okay. Margaret asks, do woodpeckers feed on dead trees?
It's a really good question. You often do see dead trees with woodpecker holes in them, right? So here's the connection. I bet you could figure this out if you just thought through it. The tree is dead, so it's full of all of this decomposing woody tissue. And one of the first things that happens is all of these insects and fungi move in and start to further break down all that ligneous hard plant tissue. So this is obviously super delicious for a woodpecker. So not all woodpeckers eat off of dead trees. In fact, there are tons and tons of living trees that support insects that are also alive that the woodpecker will also eat. But yeah, you typically will see woodpecker holes in a dead tree because they're looking for the grubs and other insects that are making use of that dead plant tissue. One of my favorite insects, actually, if I can quickly mention, you won't find it in New York, but out west, there's a woodpecker called the acorn woodpecker. And that woodpecker makes holes in, I want to say it's the coast live oak. In any case, they make holes in a living oak tree. And they, in the holes, push acorns. So you'll see an oak tree that all up and down the trunk has been bullet shot with acorns. It's the wildest behavior. I wish we had them here.
Okay, so our last question, do mockingbirds live in New York City?
Yes, and I'm so glad the mockingbird came up as one of our closing questions because northern mockingbirds, which is a very broad spread species across North America, northern mockingbirds do have small migration swings that they make. So you'll see them around now, but you'll also really dominantly see them during the growing season. Northern mockingbirds pick up calls that they hear around them. And that's not just bird song. So one of the most interesting studies that I know about are some citizen science projects in New York City where people have been recording mockingbirds for years. And you'll hear that generation after generation, and even within the single lifetime of an individual, the calls that they pick up will change. And sometimes they'll learn to make a call like a car alarm. Sometimes they'll learn to make a call like the blue jays that live around them. And so one of the neat things about mockingbirds, if you sit there and you record it and you think it through and you really parse out what they're doing, you'll actually get like a postcard of all the sounds and bird calls in your area through that one mockingbird sort of showing off everything it's got. And I find that totally fascinating. I like listening to mockingbirds here in New York and then traveling upstate and listening to mockingbirds up there. And you get a really strong sense of how different the bird populations are and how anthropocentric the birds are by the calls that they repeat back to you.
Thank you so much, Annie, for this wonderful presentation.
My pleasure.
Really enjoyed it. Please like and share this video at this event. Will be available for viewing after. In addition, subscribe to the QPL channel to get more updates on similar upcoming programs. Link for replays for upcoming events, replays for past events, or more links related to Hunters Point Environmental Education Center are in the live chat. Hope to see everyone on January 9th for the Under the Microscope DYI microscope. Thank you so much, Annie, for this beautiful presentation. I hope everyone have a wonderful day.